Cheers. And the moderator is Rolan Braslav Stringer, director of Institute of Economy of the Russian Academy of Sciences. So, we have half an hour at our disposal to share our views. As enjoying my rights as a moderator, I'd like to ask all speakers and ask a question, actually, as to... Today, we see a sort of a renaissance of Keynesianism, renaissance of Marxism. What are your feelings? What are your perceptions? What can be borrowed from those economic theories and applied in new situation? Or do we have to seek something new theories? Maybe this capitalism with human face dated back to 50-60 cannot be, resurrected. Maybe that was the golden era of capitalism and it's over and it will never have another chance to come back. And we should rather think in terms of limiting market mechanisms. As Academician Kipilov, I believe there is no alternative to market economy. I subscribe to this view, moreover so that the 70 years experiment in the Soviet Union proved that the remedy against the wild capitalism turned out to be very bitter, worse than the melody itself. So I would like to give 2 minutes to each of you and to share our this, and then we'll ask questions to the group. May I start? Since I'm on the left wing, the Marxism was mentioned, it was not by chance. We have two right wingers and left wingers in our podium. So I will start by attacking the right wing. I believe that pragmatic approach is good and limited quantities. It is good when there is a strategic objective and things should be a romantic one. In the phrase Roma, we don't see any alternative to market economy. We should make an emphasis on the word today. And the failure of the social democratic economy in the 60s was not the fatal issue. Social democracy stopped as to where they should go, whether they should go into the neoliberalism or to inflation and debt. There is a third alternative. We should modify the system of production, we should modify the system of more just and equitable distribution of the wealth. I would agree with Professor Kolodka in that indeed we have absolute necessity to place priority on science and culture development, and the person in the economy should not be the homo economicus. And I think that economic theory should proceed from the point that a person, a human being, is not only to maximize the money. The person should maximize labor, human interaction, human intercourse, free time. Otherwise, we'll never succeed in having a good life. Today, we have come to this place for a dialogue. And we should buy books and have them autographed, signed by authors. I agree with Professor Kolodka in that. Могу ли я?
Не будет нового Кейнса, не будет нового.
There won't be any new Keynes. There won't be any new Marx. Today we live in a new world. We have more than 7 billion people living on Earth. Quite soon we'll have 10 billion people living on this Earth. The second point: the processes are going on since. This is we because we live in the process of globalization, great migrations, the industrialized revolutions are taking place. We have the time of heterodoxy. There is no time for any orthodoxy now. This is a spent force, this is something which will never come back. And we should now say that we live at a time which I call in my books post-VVP time, and that means that post-GDP, we need new economic and social sciences which should be applicable in the post-GDP period. So it's not only the GDP which is the ultimate goal. In the Polish language we say this is a game of play on words. That means what the measure, it depends whether where we may arrive on the measure which we are going to take. And the maximization of profits in the microeconomy, the maximization of growth of rate in GDP in the macroeconomic level, the same will happen in errors which we make. If we say distribute, develop economies and evenly, if we are happy to have rich and poor people, no, we will never be able to put things straight. We will arrive in the situation of chaos very soon. That's why we should work fast and develop new economic ideas which should be applicable in the post-GDP period. There will be a few ideas from Neo-Keynesians, from Marxist West. Thank you, Jebish. I believe that this will be a new tour of discussion. This is a very interesting subject for discussion. Well, let us discuss the issues of new pragmatism. The dimensions of the economic life is indeed in the, because GDP is under strong attack these days, under pressure. The Stiglitz Committee and the French Committee wanted to change something in this pattern today. After the second panel discussion, we have section discussions. In this conference room, we'll have a discussion, a section discussion dealing with strategic things for Russia. We'll also dwell on those issues. But today, now, at this moment, I would like to say, ask again panelists whether we should, we live in a postmodern situation when all flowers should flourish. I would definitely agree in principle, but having common sense, I think that there is nothing can be found beyond the pragmatism. But generally, we should think of some acceptable or unified philosophy or a new economic policy. Or are we going to have economic policy for each country? Okay, I would like Oksana, and then I would like to give the floor to the, I would like you to be brief. Thank you. Thank you. I would not go too far and speak about the new philosophy, but there are facts which can be proved very easily based on the analysis of realities and the calculations about Keynesian theory. I don't know whether we should borrow from Keynes, but we should remove anti-Keynes, because everything which I spoke in terms of profit surplus economy is the use of Keynesian multiplier upside down. It operates not as a stimulator of the economic growth, but destimulator of the economic growth. And this is a fact which has been proven in real life. That's why these days we see a destimulator of the growth and inflation is not suppressed. This is what I have to say about Keynes. Keynes is alive as a proof of the fact that the opposite recipe leads to negative results. As far as the Marxism is concerned, I believe that indeed the Marx theory in assessing the value cannot be applied, because because we have a lot of innovative quality and new influence of innovative component on the price of the products, but we see a gap between the virtual economy and real economy, and the role of virtual component in GDP as well is great. That's why it misleads us, gives us wrong guidance in while we take decisions to make assessment. Another remark which I would like to say is that there are very sharp deviation between the capital function from the capital ownership, and there is a revolution of top managers in the economic life of all nations. That's why the Homo economicus, which academic Nikipel spoke of, is not a pure Homo economicus. It's a combination of Homo economicus with the Homo managericus. He rules, such new person manages, but he does not have the taste for economic risk. So there are challenges for microeconomy and macroeconomy. Both levels paradigms have changed. Now, if we have a super corporation, we don't know how to treat it, whether we should measure it in the terms of microeconomics or microeconomics. Thank you, Oksana, for your contribution. I believe that it is not possible to improve what destroys the purpose for which it was created. I am speaking about the notion of Homo economicus, because the use of the model of Homo economicus degrades the human substance to primitive needs and satisfaction of those primitive needs. When we speak about the economy, when we speak about the sociology, policy, we speak about the creativity of human beings. If a person is deprived of any stimulus for such creativity, he is a very simplified person, how much he is supposed to eat and where he should go after the, say, dinner, and how many hours he should sleep, and so on and so forth. Analyzing the global transformation which is currently taking on in the world, and recognizing that neoliberalism theory was defeated in 2008, when at the end of the day it was recognized that the world was in the state of a systemic crisis, not economic, but systemic crisis. And now that we see those attempts to address the issue of the Eurozone through requisition of certain assets, what neoliberalism can we be speaking of these days? Finally, now we witness a patented process of legalization of neocolonialism, because in any economic theory, in practice, we see that there is a center of profits, there are center of expenses, and Alfred, once speaking at the Forum of Political Civilization, the world operates in the process of nationalizations of risk privatization of profits, and this is exactly the pattern which we see on the global scale. And finally, it goes without saying that there's no one will able to say what should be the paradigm of the future development. But if we do not address those issues today, the deficit tomorrow will still be blind, will still be applying the same remedy which is prescribed for all maladies, and the world is not going to become healthy as a result of that. Thank you. I would like to make our discussion very simple, so that we shouldn't beat around the bush. Alexander Nikipelov said that the market cannot be replaced. I would subscribe to this idea too. Well, he's senior to me. He's my boss, actually. But it is indeed cannot be replaced. Buzgalin says that the market is not replaceable today. This is a very important distinction. But I would like to ask all of you, and tomorrow, day after tomorrow, I understood from Vladimir Yagunin says, is that he leans to this position that basically the method is idling or is like the faulting. Well, it's not what I was going to say. We use the old term capitalism, but we apply this term to the system which is not relative to capitalism, as we can let the market, but market economy is present now, but it's not the capitalism which they are speaking about, saying that this is a capitalism. If we look at the Marxist fall, initially we see the delineation of the labor from the capital, and then the capital, we saw the delineation of financial capital from the final product. And as a result, what we have today is we have the crisis which was studied as a financial and which ended up as a systemic crisis. I think Alfred wants to say. Feuerstein, and then Alfred will have the floor.
I think there is some kind of linguistic confusion. Market economy and capitalism are two different things. Capitalism is not a market economy. Fernand Braudel said, on the contrary, it is what he called a contre-marché, an anti-market. A market economy assumes, right, that there's a multitude of buyers, a multitude of sellers, and perfect information. If you have that, which is probably, how shall I say, a phenomenon we have had for thousands of years, right, you cannot make serious amounts of money. Capitalism requires something quite different, which is to suppress the market economy and create a situation of quasi-monopolies, which, however, are self-exhausting. In order to have a quasi-monopoly so that you can charge serious amounts of money and therefore accumulate capital, you need assistance from the state. You are pro-state, not anti-state. You need the state to guarantee your quasi-monopolies, right? So that's the first thing. Right? Capitalism is not a market economy, it's an anti-market economy. Secondly, I bring in a concept which is widely discussed in Latin America but less discussed in the rest of the world, right? Which is the call for a civilizational transformation. In their language, to call for a society of buen vivir, to live well. But what does that mean? That means that they want to create, they would like to have a situation, a structure in which growth per se is not the objective, but rather a rational discussion about the ecological possibilities of sustainable life, and the right of autonomous structures across the world. This would be a fundamental transformation from what we have now. And it is, I think, one of the possible outcomes of this bifurcation of which I have been speaking. But let us be very clear about the fact that market does not equal capitalism, and capitalism does not equal market.
Very important observation. This is new.
So first of all, I entirely agree with Professor Wallerstein that capitalism starts where markets end. Because when you analyze competition as one element of market economy, the aim of capitalism is to finish competition and to establish monopolies where you can create extra profits.
And I'm talking about existing.
Of course,
I'm
talking about the real existing capitalism. Just to paraphrase something
else. Is this existing capitalism market economy or not market?
No, the existing capitalism has finished the market economy. And that is part of our problem. Because capitalism is a power structure. It's not an economic model, it's a power structure that as a collateral result produces unequal distribution of means and instruments around the world. The second thing is What I think is important if you look to societies. Okay, GDP is one way of measuring, but there are other elements that are much more important. Questions like social mobility in a society, the possibility to make your way up through different layers of the society. The second thing that is important is innovation. If I would be in Russia, I would, for instance, ask myself, how could it be possible that a country with such enormous, enormous intellectual capacity, especially in the sector of natural sciences, a country with all the means that you need, and a country that has, well, I mean, most of the top intellectual people, why does such a country like Russia not be the start-up nation number one in the world, but it is a country like Israel, where many, as you know, natural scientists from Russia were emigrating, and in this small country, with an enormous academic and intellectual capacity, they were building most of the high-tech companies apart from the United States. So why is this possible there, and why is this not possible in Russia? This is a question I would ask myself, because then you might arrive to institutional questions, you might arrive to the question how innovation is produced in the society, and how one maybe can also overcome some of the elements of crony capitalism that you have right now.
Your question will be answered after you fly to Austria, okay, after the lunch. But you will be informed about the answer. Я думаю, мне очень интересно знать мнение
академика Никипелова по поводу того, что капитализм начинается там, где кончается рыночная экономика. Я такого никогда не слышал, но когда-то надо начинать. Да.
Спасибо. Я согласен с профессором Уллерстайном, что, наверное, здесь проблема терминологического характера. Потому что, я думаю, никакой здравомыслящий человек не думает, что современная экономика является экономикой свободной конкуренции. Этого никто не думает. Но из этого совсем не следует, что понимание законов функционирования свободной конкуренции не является важным для того, чтобы понять, что потом происходит и как потом это деформируется, почему и так далее. То же самое относится к экономическому человеку. Я так же, как, кстати говоря, сам Адам Смит, автор этой концепции, не считаю, и он не считал, что человек является экономическим человеком. Это абстракция, которая позволяет многие вещи, не все, но многие, объяснить. Она позволяет, если на технические позиции становиться, объяснить, почему цена падает в большинстве случаев, когда предложение увеличивается или спрос падает и так далее. Но это совершенно не означает, что Смит считал, что все качества человека сводятся именно к качествам экономического человека. Это разные вещи. По поводу вот ВВП, Гжегош поднял этот важный вопрос, он, на мой взгляд, он является частью более широкого и очень серьезного вопроса. Это вот одна из тех вещей, которые остаются загадкой для экономической теории. После того, как Кеннет Эрроу сформулировал теорему о возможности, или о невозможности, как ее часто называют, когда выяснилось, что невозможно сформулировать, ну, в рамках тех предположений, которые были, что представляет из себя система групповых интересов. А этот вопрос
brings about the fact that today in economic science there are two absolutely different branches, microeconomy, which proceeds from the fact that interpersonal comparison, let's say well-being, they are not possible to achieve, and macroeconomics, which summarizes value parameters and considers them as a characteristics of the level of successful development. And it doesn't matter that the GDP is a bad parameter. There are certain attempts to choose other. The microeconomics operates vectors, and macroeconomics trying to compress for convenience of practical use and to offer it as a scalable value, as a number. So GDP could be added by environmental component, but it will not differ its index as a scalable value. And the last thing concerning Marx, I think that he was a distinguished scientist, and his heritage is very important, for he set a task to create an integrated a comprehension of how economic system is functioning, because now it is disintegrated. Thank you. We still have 5 minutes, and I'd like to read a note. Perhaps we will make it public. This is Vladimir Baglaev, the general manager of Cherepovets Casting and Metal Works. Perhaps there is a difference of approach of our and foreign speakers. They are talking about problems and think how to solve it, and our speakers are talking how bad it was done, but they never speak who did that and who is going to correct that. Please, this is the question. And the answer is clear. So I think that there is a difference in mentality, and the problem who is to blame and what needs to be done is our Russian problem, and I think we are going to solve it after lunchtime. We are going to have a discussion on economic